Welcome everyone. I'm Sister Barbara Reed. I'm the Vice President and Academic Dean here at CTU, and it's my distinct pleasure to be able to welcome you to this 11th Tolton Lecture. This is the 21st year of the program, so the program is of age. And for the past dozen years, it has been under the directorship of Vanessa White. We are so proud of this program. Our Augustus Tolton Scholarship Program is the only graduate scholarship and formation program of its kind. As you know, it's in collaboration with the Archdiocese of Chicago, preparing Black Catholic men and women for ministerial leadership in the church. This is also a very special year for the Tolton program. As you know, in the fall, The cause for canonization for Father Augustus Tolton was opened, and so are you going to say something about that, Vanessa?
Probably after.
After, very good. So we are delighted to welcome you to this event this afternoon, and I want to introduce now Dr. C. Vanessa White, who is Assistant Professor of Spirituality and the Director of the Augustus Tolton Program, who will introduce our speaker for us this afternoon. Vanessa?
Thank you, Barbara. It is so good to be here, and it's especially good to have Dr. Anna Kasafi-Perkins. Anna Kasafi-Perkins is the former Dean of Studies at St. Michael's Theological College, an institute of the Roman Catholic Archdiocese of Kingston, Jamaica, and an affiliated institution of the University of West Indies. She is currently the Senior Program Officer in the Quality Assurance Unit at the University of the West Indies, Mona, and adjunct faculty at St. Michael's. She holds a Bachelor of Arts in Theology, First Class Honors from the University of West Indies and St. Michael's Seminary, a Master's in Philosophy, Christian Theology from Cambridge University, and a PhD in Theological Ethics from Boston College. She is the editor of St. Michael's journal, Groundings. Her research interests include faith and political life, sex and sexuality, religion and popular culture, gender and the scriptures, business and professional ethics. She has a particular interest in the dance hall space and the peculiar contribution of artist Tanya Stephens. Her reflection on Stephens' music include Love the Long Ding Dong, Tanya Transgresses Christian Sensibilities in 2010, Tasting Tears and Not Admitting Defeat, Promoting Values and Attitudes Through the Music of Tanya Stephens, the inaugural lecture of Social Ethics Center in 2008. Her most recent publication, which you have a little bit of a bio about that on your seat, is a book entitled Justice as Equality, Michael Manley's Caribbean Vision of Justice, published by Peter Lang Publishers in 2010. She is a member of the Black Catholic Theological Symposium, the Catholic Theological Society of America, and the Catholic Theology in the Caribbean Today. She is also a board member of Caribbean Catholics in North America. More recently, she was a member of the second drafting group of the World Council of Churches Statement on Just Peace 2010. Now, a personal note. I met Dr. Perkins several years ago when Dr. M. Sean Copeland was giving her presidential address at the Catholic Theological Society of America. And let me tell you, that was a glorious time just to be together. And I said then that one day I was going to have you here. And so I am so proud to present Dr. Perkins, whose lecture is entitled, Carib-being and Theology These Days, The Unwitting Theological Enterprise of the Music of Tanya Stephens.
Good afternoon. It's a distinct honor to be here this afternoon. I know that I stand in the footsteps of really great people that have come before me and done marvelous things. People who have worked hard in the areas of service and scholarship, particularly Father Augustus Tolton, for whom this lecture is named. And I hope that what I share with you this afternoon will really honor his life and his work and the lives of many Black Catholics that have come after. I particularly want to say thank you to the leadership of CTU for so generously supporting this program. And a very special thanks to you, Madame Butterfly, for keeping up with me and getting me here.
That's a personal.
And I want to thank you all for coming to share the occasion with me. I see so many friends that I have not seen in so many years that are here, and I really, really appreciate having you, John, Loren, you know, there are just so many of you. Thank you. Now, where do I begin? You know, I mean, what on earth is a good little Catholic girl doing listening to dancehall music? And worse than that, you know what she's doing? She's attempting to do theology with it. All right, well, I have to give you all of my reasons, but perhaps the main reason is that somewhere around 2001, when I was doing doctoral studies, I was the grad assistant with Sean Copeland at BC. And she was working on an article on Black political theologies. I remember, you know, you were having conversations, and one thing that struck me that has always remained with me was that Sean said that as she looked at the theological work that was going on in the Caribbean region, she could see the cutting edge of theological work being done in our music. That really, really struck me. And in fact, in that same piece that we were working on, I'm going to quote from it, she says that Black political theology goes to school by listening to the vernacular. It absorbs street smarts as well as critical theory. It knows funk, reggae, rap, and dread. It's rhythm wise and scripture smart. And what's going on there with Black theology, Black political theology? She's arguing that Black political theology values ordinary people's critical consciousness of their own predicament and prizes subjugated knowledges. She finds that that sort of insight will be echoed in the Caribbean because we claim that we like to do theology from unconventional spaces. We flirt with theology of cricket or theology of carnival or theology of other kinds of cultural practices. And so I would want to argue, and I hope that this is something I'm going to really make a contribution in, that if we want to do theology from our usual unconventional places, we need to pay attention to dancehall, to hip-hop, to soca. And so in doing that, though, I recognize that I'm going to find some opposition. There's going to be a counter-discourse that's going to be at work, that's going to limit theology to a particular group of trained, privileged persons, usually men, pastors, priests, theologians, and the same discourse is going to try to limit theology to particular spaces as well. So it's the church, or it's a seminary, or it's a good Bible study, or maybe if even to be limited to particular books of theology or scripture. But guess what? I'm not deterred, or I'm misguided. So I'm attempting to take my Caribbean heritage seriously, and I'm also paying heed to the direct encouragement of Dr. Copeland, who I consider to be a theological mentor. And so where possible, I do look critically at my cultural and material practices from the region, and I'm especially fond of all popular music, and that's a source for me of theological reflection, although I recognize that my taste might not be everybody's taste, and you know, what I like is skewed in one direction or the other. So one of my favorite artists is Tanya Stephens. She's a Jamaican sing jay or dancehall artist. That's her up there, that's from her, if not, that's three albums back, Gangsta Blues. The latest album that she has is one called Infallible. And you can actually get Infallible online, free of cost. She has put her music out there for the world to have access to it. So maybe after I'm done this afternoon, a couple of you might go and download one or two tracks from Imbalo. Bless you. So I'm going to pull some pieces and share them with you this afternoon from her three albums, her last three ones. The one we're looking at here is called Gangster Blues. The other one that comes after is called Revolution. And then the final one that came out last year is Infallible. Now, I think there are two spaces that is pretty important for us to explore briefly before we launch into our reflection. The space of the dance hall and the space of the Caribbean. I'm going to start with the Caribbean, which I think is a term that invokes all kinds of imaginings. Yeah, the islands and the territories of the Caribbean take their name from the sea that laps their shores. This sea, in turn, was named for the indigenous Caribs who refused to bow to European rule and are forever misrepresented in history as savage man-eaters, cannibals, Caliban. From a conceptual point of view, there are probably at least four ways of viewing the Caribbean. One, you can talk about the Caribbean as the islands in the Caribbean Sea, the Greater and the Lesser Antilles, so we're talking about Jamaica, Cuba, Puerto Rico, places like that. Or you could talk about the Caribbean as the Caribbean Basin. All the countries in and around the Caribbean Sea, so it's widened it a little bit more to include places like Guyana and Suriname and so on. Both of those perspectives, very geographical, I think, are pretty limiting, but they're usually the ones that people have in mind when they think of the Caribbean. There's a third conceptual way of looking at it, the ethno-historical Caribbean. And what we're doing here, that we're looking at the islands and the adjacent coastal communities in South and Central America who share a common history, culture, and ethnicity, though they might be divided by language, insularity, and fragmentation. So this would include, for example, countries like Belize, Panama, even parts of Costa Rica, depending on what is it that you're looking for. I think this is a much more comprehensive way of looking at the Caribbean, and it's the one in a certain way that I subscribe to. Although the fourth conceptual way of looking at the Caribbean is one that pays attention to the diaspora, the recognition that there's a Caribbean outside of the Caribbean. And many of you in here are probably connected to that diaspora in some way. You're probably first or second generation Caribbean descended by Karen, or you're probably Caribbean born, or like Chris, you visited the Caribbean, or like Father Paul's and Uncle back there, you've lived for many years in the Caribbean and shaped many lives like my own. So in some way, many of us in here tonight have been and are in some way Caribbean. Now, in Jamaica, we like to talk about Miami as what we call Kingston 20. We say Kingston 21. We say Miami, which you know, is just there jotting down above us, is Kingston 21 because so many Jamaicans live in Miami. It's like the last postal district of Jamaica. I suspect the Cubans will probably say the same thing as well because they have a wonderful Cuban community in Miami as well. I say that because this whole notion of the Caribbean identity being a diasporic one is one that I think we really have to take very seriously. I'm told, for example, that one in every six baseball players here in the US actually originated somewhere in the Dominican Republic. Mm-hmm. Yeah? Or when I look at the Canada had a poster that they put out recently to honor black Canadians. Two of those people on that poster were actually Jamaican born. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I could go on, you know, just listing all of the different ways that this Caribbean diaspora has had an impact on the larger world in a way that, that goes against the size of the region. So clearly we are a significant and we have a voice that needs to be heard, and you're hearing some of that tonight. Now, among the nations of the Caribbean, there are those that have historic connections with the British Empire, right? The ones that we call the Anglophone or the Commonwealth Caribbean, of which Jamaica is perhaps the best known, or maybe the most notorious. Everybody knows Bob Marley, right? Mm. Everybody thinks we're down there smoking ganja and yeah, man, everything all right, you know? If I ask you, what's the characteristic, you know, expression that's Jamaican, what would you say?
Yeah, man.
Now, believe me, I really believe that that was the characteristic expression of Jamaican. I never thought I said it. So a couple years back, I'm floating through the airport in Miami and I encounter a Haitian porter and, you know, he starts to talk to me and then he finds out I'm Jamaican. I'm saying, how can you say yeah, man like the rest of them? So I was quite offended, you know. All Jamaicans don't say yeah, man. I go off later and I say to one of my friends, this is what happened.
He says to me, "You're so good, man." And I just blew me away. So I said, "Oh, I'm Jamaican after all." No, this Anglophone Caribbean community has been accused of cultural arrogance because of its proprietary and often limited way of understanding Caribbean. Indeed, Norman Gerwin charges that the cultural arrogance of the Anglophones in the Caribbean is only exceeded by our geographical ignorance and strategic myopia. Kind of sounds like the same kind of critique we launch at the USA, but believe it or not, we suffer from very similar concerns as well. To many of us, you know, we're blissfully unaware that we're just 1/5 of the population, the land mass, and the GDP of the island Caribbean. And we're certainly much less than that if you take in the mainland territories and all of that as well. So this Anglo-centric vision of the region, Gerwin calls a West Indian rather than Caribbean vision. So in a certain way, we can blame the British. Now we're not interested in anybody else. So recognizing that we do have this sort of myopia, I do come from an island such as Jamaica, where we feel we are it in the region and everybody else needs to look up to us, right? And then also having on the other side the experience where being Caribbean, particularly Anglophone Caribbean, sometimes we get subsumed under Latin America and the Caribbean, and our own voice is not heard. I've deliberately talked about this perspective that I'm presenting as being Jamaican Caribbean, so that I can sort of hold together the concerns in some kind of tension. Now, some of what I'm going to say this afternoon is going to have resonance with some of my Caribbean brothers and sisters, and for others it may not. The next space we have to talk about is a dance hall. It's a part that's a little bit easier to define, but it's no less fraught a space in terms of contention around this particular space or place. Now, dance hall music takes its name from the place for staging dances, and it builds on the tradition of Jamaican resistance music from the post-independence period. So all resistance music at that time would have included ska, mento, dub, rock steady, and roots rock reggae. And you're perhaps a lot more familiar with reggae of the Bob Marley version. Yeah? Mm-hmm. Now Donna Hope, who is a renowned dance hall researcher, places the origins of dance hall in the social, political, and economic constraints of Jamaica in the 1980s. Dance hall features DJs and singjays singing over popular rhythm, often creating lyrics on the spot. So these guys, for the most part, they're guys who are very talented with their ability to do that and to do that in the Jamaican language. Dancehall, as the most pervasive and persistent manifestation of Jamaican popular culture, is perhaps akin to calypso for Trinidad and Tobago, and it's the creation of the marginalized inner-city Jamaican poor. It's a male-dominated space that gives voice to the voiceless, while encompassing their bid for survival and escape from the poverty-stricken lifestyles of the inner cities of Kingston and St. Andrew. Today, it is internationally recognized and celebrated. Japanese women come to Jamaica and vie to win the title of dancehall queen, and one or two of them have won. Okay? The best writing on the dancehall genre comes out of Europe. In fact, comes out of Germany. There's a magazine there called Rhythm Magazine, just celebrating its 10th anniversary. Best sort of reflection that you could think of on dancehall. What about reggaeton, which is the Latin-influenced reggae dancehall fusion that has started to take wings? Dancehall is no longer simply local. It's very much international. Now, not all evaluations of dancehall have been positive, however. Several commentators, including a well-known Jamaican critic, Ian Boy, has charged that dancehall is actually a betrayal of reggae. In Boyd's words, dancehall represents the tragic case of the child doing violence to the mother. He sees the message of dancehall today as being, and I quote, "the objectification and commodification of women, the glorification of promiscuity. It's about power over women's bodies, even to the point of rape." He laments that in the dance hall, women's bodies are not their own, and they simply beautify them for men's use. Coupled with this is the glorifying of the dons, the shutters, the bad men, and the worshipping of guns. Listen to Boyne again. He says, "What we have in the dance hall is the glorification of the gun, the inciting of violence. And when we don't have the vulgarity, which is hailed as the expression of female liberation, and the gun talk, we have the promotion of bling bling and Western materialistic and hedonistic values, the values of Babylon, end quote. In light of this, Boyne is strident in his critique of academics for uncritically, as we say in Jamaica, bigging up ghetto authenticity without being critical of the negative aspects of dancehall. Now, the concerns with the method of dancehall are certainly regional and international. You remember several of our dancehall artists have been banned or had their concerts canceled both here and in Europe because of their violent anti-homosexual lyrics. Right in our own region, islands like Barbados, Grenada, Trinidad and Tobago have banned some of our artists or even stopped their music from being played on the airwaves. So you can imagine, this whole thing about dancehall is highly, highly emotive in our Jamaican space, and many Jamaicans are up in arms for anybody even thinking of banning our music. But what they end up doing is that when they overreact, they don't even pay attention to their own space. They forget that some of these same artists that are banned abroad are also banned, as we say in Jamaica, banned a yard. Mm-hmm. You know? So we recognize that there are some issues with this genre of music. So into all of this, and in spite of this, all the powerful negative dancehall voices that are out there, I found a voice, and she's not the only one, but for the moment, she's the one I'm interested in. I found one voice that does not glorify violence, does not favor any kind of hedonistic materialism or even the commodifying of women. She's Tanya Stephens. Her music is fraught with controversy, don't make any mistake about that. But I think she has an important and powerful voice that I want to share with you a little bit about today. Now, many people know Tanya Stephens as the artist whose albums have parental advisory notices on them about explicit content. And I'm going to warn you that one or two of the pieces that I might play for you this afternoon may contain expletives. The fact is, though, that her language is Jamaican, the Creole, and also the English. So I suspect that you might not quite catch some of what she said. And as I go along, I'm not going to translate the expletives, though, but I'll translate what I can of the other stuff as I'm going to play. So others see her as a self-proclaimed gangster girl, and of course you can see some of that in the imagery of this particular album that Vanessa has put up for us today. You see the bullets around the space, you see her in a hat, and she has these huge dancehall earrings in and that kind of thing. So she's projecting a particular image there, but she's actually projecting, you know, to say something against it, which is very important for me. So others see her as a self-proclaimed gangster gal who talks tough to men and is dismissive of her female rivals. So she's saying, you don't have to like me, but you have to respect my skills. So she's saying, you don't have to like me, but you have to recognize that I'm very skilled. I'm very, very talented. She's one of those female artists who can be described as raunchy, as she rides the sexual thrust of the dancehall in her own suggestive way. At the same time, she rebuffs attacks on the female body and feminine sexuality with lyrics that in turn derogate male arrogance in their sexual performance and right to conquer the female body. In another space, and Dr. White did point that out to you when she was going through my CV, I've described her as a transgressor, one who goes about goes across established boundaries and calls into question what is considered taboo, especially Christian taboos concerning sex and sexuality. But we're not talking about this today. Sorry. Every voice she speaks, it is not her own, though. Some of her voices, especially the female voices, are deliberately contradictory and present different sides, especially if she's looking at the female-male-female triangle. Nonetheless, I believe that every artist is revealed in her art. And even in those contradictory voices, something of her perspective can be captured or identified. In her most clearly autobiographical piece, which is entitled Who is Tanya?, which comes on her Revolution album, she states that her power does not reside in stripping for control them mania. Yet she proclaims confidently that the man them forget a good ride, and that Tanya believe. So she's really rejecting that dimension of dancehall that commodifies the female body and locates a woman's worth in her ability to bring pleasure to a man. She needs approval from no one and desires to be compared to no other. So she declares, although the mic is her favorite utensil, she's still number one with a number two pencil. Yeah. Yeah, you hear the beauty of the lyrics? No. Yeah? She proudly declared that world domination had a plan. Her repertoire is liberally dotted with deeply conscious pieces in which she critiques social relations in Jamaica and the world. I'm going to play one or two of them for you. She does not back away from social concerns like alcoholism, which she treats in a humorous but very deadly fashion. She talks about racism and homophobia. She talks about rape. She talks about the HIV/AIDS stigma. And she even talks about a particularly troubling phenomenon in our Jamaican context, which we call jacketing. And it's this whole concern that we have that some women deliberately name wrong men as the father of their children, and what's going on behind that, and why do they do that. I'm going to let her speak for herself for a little bit. Could we play Welcome to the Revolution? It's the first track, that's number one. Are you ready for a revolution? Because that's her agenda. She wants to create change by inspiring one rebel at a time. It's not about revolution, where things are going to come back in a cycle. It's about change, and change is going to start with each one of us. Yeah? So there's a lot about how the world runs and how people live their lives that she wants to change. And she knows that music, her music, is an important tool in changing the world. This rebel consciousness makes her, for me, one of the most lyrically exciting artists in the dance hall today. She has a talent for words and quite an impressive vocabulary. You know, in one of her albums, she has a piece that she calls Spilled Milk, and that describes a relationship that would have gone sour anyway. Mm-hmm. Or she, when she's in an alcoholic funk, you know, she laments ruefully that when it comes to passing the bar, she's not the best student. Or she's pleading with her gangster man to spend time with her and not on the street. She describes herself by saying, your girl is a perfect 10, but your bedroom is only a 5 and a 6. No, I could not understand that. I didn't have a clue what she was talking about until I learned that Ben's come in numbered series. So you have Ben's 500, Ben's 600. That's what she's talking about. And a lot of her stuff is about cars too, and she talks about guns and all of that, because that's part of what she's going against in her rebel consciousness as she presents it out there to us. Now, being a Jamaican, her language is suffused with allusions too, and direct references to the Bible. So you heard her in that piece where she said, when non-believers wanted to nail my hands to the mic stand. Yeah? So you're hearing the allusion there to Christ and what is done to Christ. You know, she treats with deep questions around transcendence and transience, which is a key bipolarity that has been identified by anthropologist Diane Austin Bruce as a feature of Jamaican Caribbean experience or identity. Austin Bruce argues that the constant experience of change or danger leads people in search for an anchor whereby they can transcend the present. Quote, many Jamaicans have sought such rootedness, hidden attachments to God, antecedents, or the land, anchors that withstand the hurricanes of transience, end quote. This bipolarity is not unique to Jamaica. The Caribbean is pervaded by dualism. That is the propensity to classify in terms of oppositions. We can talk about this later. Europe versus Africa, inside versus outside, reputation versus respectability. These are some of the key themes that can be used to sort of pull together notions of what it means to be Caribbean. The coming together of bipolarities can be seen in many of the region's popular religious experiences. For example, Vodun of Haiti, or Kumina in Jamaica, Winti in Suriname, Rastafari. These are all the results of a sort of syncretizing process that has brought together African belief systems with European religious traditions. Again, bipolarities working, but coming together in very unique ways. Milton George, who is a Surinamese theologian, highlights these oppositions when he speaks of, and I quote, an almost invisible flow of bipolarities running through Caribbean life and making it what it is. He therefore sees a new theological voice groping its way to the surface in the midst of such a puzzling mixture. He therefore calls for the redefinition and re-examination of theology within the context of the religious experience of the people from the Caribbean region. That is, a Caribbean theology, or as he says, maybe Caribbean theologies, more than one. This Caribbean theology is not simply the purview of the theologian, scholar, priest. As Ashley Smith reminds us, everyone theologizes, or everyday expressions, my God, Lord have mercy, God bless you. They're all theological assertions. When we utter such expressions, we assume that there is a greater being to whom we can appeal in times of need. According to Smith, and I quote, the simple, less school believer theologizes in simplistic terms, yes, but is wrestling with the same things as the person who speaks of God in more sophisticated terms, end quote. The task of Caribbean theology, then, in my estimation, is to allow the deeply contextual experience of Caribbean peoples in our quest to discern what God is doing with and among us to be given expression in both our sophisticated and our simple language and living. This is not a neutral theology. It's not an unchanging process. Neither will it make claims at universality. But what it will do is to privilege the experience of Caribbean peoples, especially those whose voices have been silenced and whose knowledges have been subjugated. Exploring Tanya's work, I think, is another contribution to this process. Now, let me show you a little bit about how she sees the world. Because social commentary is a very important dimension of her work. She's clear that she has a call to put into word the experience of the voiceless and the oppressed of Jamaican society who are not being listened to. Because she says, the people themselves are talk and nobody are listening all along. So then why we put it in the form of a song? Simply she's saying, the people say that they've been speaking for a long time, nobody is listening, so they've asked her, could you put the experience that we've been talking about for so long in a song? Because people will listen when you sing. And that's what she did. She had a piece that's called What a Day, and you're going to see running through a lot of what I'm talking about this afternoon, which calls to mind, for me at any rate, King's beloved I Have a Dream speech. In it, she shares her vision of a new day in a fashion that exposes the problems with our current world. In that piece, we hear several of her key themes coming up. Her radical critique of religious, political, and social life, her rejection of a sort of classist morality that made judgments on persons based on external features, for example, their hair, their musical taste, the money they have or don't have. She critiques parental irresponsibility, social exclusion and deprivation, and their impact on crime and violence. Can we play What a Day? It's the track that's numbered 16.
Tired of the hunger I see on people's faces. Tired of the animosity between the races. Tired of corruption in high and low places. And bricks with money but no social graces. Tired of being judged for the style of my hair. And the music that I listen and the clothes that I wear. Tired of life and death being so unfair. And politicians who keep saying they care, but maybe hoping for a change is a dream. And maybe life ain't as bad as it seems. But if dreaming is the best I can do, then I'll be dreaming my whole life through. Oh, what a day when war becomes a thing of the past and peace. We will have it at last, and life is finally worth its cost. And whoa, 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 what a day when men live what they teach and love ain't just the concept you preach. And blood no longer runs in the streets. Whoa, 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 oh, what a day. Tired of leaving church feeling like I've just been robbed. 2 hours of rambling, not much mention of God. The richest man's the only one who does not have a job. A bunch of righteous freaks extorting words in a mob, y'all. Tired of baby mama, tired of baby daddy. Chilling in the spot where the parents should be. Teenage mother saying, leave my babies alone. 20 years a kid could be robbing my home. Boy, I got a vision of a whole other place. For the spiritual can flourish again. I'm just waiting for the fire to rain. Bundong everything and start clean. What a day when war becomes a thing of the past and peace. We will have it at last, and life is finally worth its cost. And whoa, 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 what a day when men finally live what they teach. And love ain't just a concept we preach. And blood no longer runs in the streets. And whoa, 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 oh, what a day, oh. Ooh, what a day, oh.
Dreaming of a day when people will be no longer hungry, when animosity between racial groups is gone, when corruption in high and low places is done away with, and war has become a thing of the past. She rejects the corruption that she identifies as also being present in the church, and she presents a vision of a new day. Yet sometimes she fears, you know, that maybe that day is not really possible, and she's simply dreaming. Nonetheless, she's going to keep on dreaming, so maybe all hope is not lost. I don't know if you realized it, but very interestingly, her point of reference in that song is Jamaica, the United States, and the wider world. At no point does she explicitly reference the Caribbean. at all. And I found that this is a situation that was all of her music. In fact, I want us to explore just for a minute the fact that she, in her music, seems to so identify with the African-American experience that it has, in a certain way, blocked out the larger and wider Caribbean experience. For example, the next piece that we're going to play is entitled, Do You Still Care? And in this piece, she identifies with the struggles of African-Americans for their civil rights in the context of racism and discrimination and so on. Yet nowhere in that piece does the historic struggles of her own Caribbean people get remarked on. And that's very, very interesting for a Jamaican woman and something we need to reflect on as we're talking about Caribbean and doing theology today. It's the first track, that's Labor 15.
When they used to hang ropes, they always get to up and cross the screen all night like the church grew up. And if you didn't look like them, they would fuck you up. Time passed, and Baba turned 40 years old. And all of that matter started taking a toll. Seemed like Baba was about to make a final bow. None of his friends on the planet couldn't help him now. Family gathered at his bedside, ready to sing the blues. When a doctor rushed in and said, I got some news. Why can't you accept me as I am?
telling the story of two men, Bobo, who is supposedly a white racist, whose life was saved by a liver transplant from a black man. And then she tells the story of Bigger, who's a Jamaican male who grows up hating gays. So you heard her say at a point, chichi for dead. That's the way that Jamaican men talk about gay men and what should happen to them. So he grows up hating gays, but ends up having his life saved by men who are driving a car that sports hate that says gay pride. The American reality of racism and discrimination shades into overlays and mirrors the homophobic reality of Jamaica. The diasporic identity of the Jamaican-Caribbean person is captured in Bigger, who clearly now resides in the U.S. after having grown up in Jamaica. She challenges both men and us, who are formed in communities with definitive rules about what's wrong or right, to accept those who they consider different, those who do things differently. Her question to the new Bubba and Bigger echoes the love command. Do you still find it hard to love your neighbor as you love yourself? The question of the neighbor is thrown into stark relief in both cases, as both of these men have now become the neighbor, the one who is in need. The black donor and the gay man, like the Samaritan in the Lucan story, are the ones considered other, enemy, inferior, yet in turn are able to overlook those in the service of the neighbor. Challenging the hatred of gay people in Jamaican society, I think, is a very brave move on her part, because she functions in a dancehall space that is considered to be very highly homophobic. In fact, not that I listen to a lot of the dancehall music out there because of the very problems that are there with dancehall, but I've not found another dancehall artist that has treated this topic in this kind of forthright fashion. Now notice her concern with acceptance goes beyond Jamaica and the US borders and extends to the Middle East with the Israeli and the Palestinian conflict. Even the war in Iraq features, but nowhere is there any specific reference or even an allusion to the challenges that we're facing in the Caribbean region. In another piece she has that's called We've Come a Long Way, we have her talking to the heroes and heroines of the civil rights movement. So she talks to Martin and she talks to Malcolm and she talks to Rosa. And in the same breath she talks to Jamaica's Marcus Garvey. And she kind of questions, you know, whether black people have been living up to the legacy of the three people and whether their personal sacrifice was really worth it and so on. And she critiques people of color, she critiques black people for so readily accepting the name nigger, but continuing to live in ways that denigrate each other by some of the ways we treat each other. So she's not afraid to turn the critique that she lodges out there inside as well. I want to share with you a couple of the things about what's going on in Tanya that I find very arresting. Now, two of our favorite groups, and when I say favorite, I put them in quotation marks, two of our favorite groups are politicians and Christians. She's not very fond of either of them. And I'm going to tell you why. People usually tell you, you know, if you want to be very polite, you don't speak about religion or politics. But she's very impolite. She speaks about both, and oftentimes she does it in the same breath. So we find that she's very scornful of organized religion and tribal politics. And so tell her that, you know, you've spent your life being involved with religion or politics. She's going to dismiss you, you know. Those two dimensions of life are too divisive, particularly in our Jamaican context. And ironically, while being divisive are also sources of real change, potential for change, you know, but of course we recognize that both can function in either way. So I could walk you through the whole concern that she has with politics and so on, but I'm going to leave that for now. And I want to focus a little bit on her perspective on God, which shows up quite a bit in some of her pieces. She has a piece called Sunday Morning, where she takes a very careful broadside at Christianity. And this, interestingly, this piece called Sunday Morning follows a piece that's called Saturday Morning. And Saturday Morning is the story about this woman who wakes up after she has a drunk Friday night and finds the results of her drunkenness in the bed beside her. And you know, she makes all kinds of promises to herself to not do this again. And then when she gets rid of her problem, as the problem is going through the door, she says, "Oh, by the way, pass me a beer." So she's asking him as he's leaving to give her a beer. after she had promised us that she was never going to do this again. And what she's really showing us is that alcoholism is not a joke. Mm-hmm. It's not something that you're going to get over by willpower. Yeah? And we could talk a lot about that. She talks about Christians, and you heard it, that she calls us a bunch of righteous freaks extorting worse than the mob. No, she ain't being complimentary, and I don't like to hear it. But listen to her, because I want to hear if there's anything there that's worthwhile. She talks about rejecting the Christian message because it's so toxic, as it's delivered by some Christians, who, in her opinion, suffer from some kind of psychosis. You know, maybe it's delusions of grandeur or superiority complexes, who knows? And so she dismisses Christians who, you know, during the week sit on this perch and look down at sinners and then only want to interact with them on Sunday when they're invited to church and that kind of thing. And she's very naughty. She's so naughty. She says, the same set of people who say God lives in the sky, the same set of people who criticize me when I get high. And they even have a problem with my drinking. And I say, fine, but if Jesus had a problem with drinking, would he turn water into wine? So she's poking some serious fun at the contradictions that there are in how some of us live our Christianity. We can have some concerns too, though, about how she views stuff like marijuana and drinking and all of that. We also have to launch our own critique of some of what she's presenting to us at the same time. And there are lots of resonance in her work with the Rastafari community, for example, the fact of the smoking of marijuana as a tool or an instrument that allows them to get to a certain space, that allows them to commune with the divine, and at the same time allows them to have some very deep reasonings among themselves and so on. So there's all of that that's going on there with her. But let's talk about God for a second before I have to end. Oh, she don't like clergy either. Some people say no to drugs. Tanya says no to clergy. She doesn't want any clergy between her and God. And, you know, the complaint she had about preaching and all of that. And she calls the preacher the richest man in the place who doesn't have a job. Yeah? And that ties in with her concern that she has been extorted by the church, because, you know, she goes to church, the man talks for 2 hours, she doesn't hear one word about God, but clearly what she's hearing about is all the bling and the materialism. So the critique that she makes of church is the same critique that needs to be made of the dance hall culture as well, where all of that materialism and so on is pretty much at play. We, in our Christian faith, we have concerns about the prosperity gospel, yeah? And it's some of that she's also concerned about. And she likes the Bible too, believe it or not. Like lots of Jamaicans, she has a deep knowledge and respect for the Bible, and she believes that the Bible is the King James Bible, and that the Bible is the original language. And so in the piece that I have not played for you, she talked to King James, and she said to me, you know, not even one little verse from a woman. Because she knows, in her mind, he wrote the Bible, and he wrote it, so he's the male voice, no woman's voice in there. Well, guess what? That's not going to stop her. So she says, behold the Chronicles of Tanya. Yeah. And the next song that she has is a piece called You Keep Looking Up. Could you play that for me, Marie? It's number 13.
You keep looking up, why don't you look around you? I am everywhere.
She's telling us that God is not found in the sky. It's, you know, the same place that she can get to when she gets high, right? God is not this transcendent being that's far away from humanity. No. God is to be found in and around us. I am everywhere. I am now. her repetition of the I am statement, to my mind, alludes to the divine name coming out of, you know, God's self-revelation to Moses in the Exodus. Similarly, I think that she's also recalling for us the I am statements of Jesus in John's Gospel that, you know, echoes and indicates Jesus' divinity. Well, what I think is going on here, though, when I hear it, I think to myself, wait, hold on, is she a pantheist? Yeah? Because she's saying God is everything, right? And if God is everything, therefore logically everything is God. Reasonable? I'm on the right path? And I see a similar sort of logic that's playing out in Rastafarianism and their own syllogism that says God is a black man. Selassie? So if God is a black man, therefore black man is God. Now please note, not black woman, black man. Alright? But I actually looked at her again and realized maybe she's not as pantheistic as she sounds. And you know, if that were the case, there are all kinds of questions that we can ask about such a pantheistic vision. Maybe her perspective is more pan-entheist. Yeah? And I say this because she doesn't really reject God or a creator God. In fact, she is yearning after some kind of relationship with God. And we know that she believes that God is and that God has this care for individuals, particularly God's human creation. So we have one of her pieces where, for example, she calls upon the universe, slash Jah, which is the Rasta way of referring to God, to punish the man who left her when she needed him most. Another time she calls upon God for a little reciprocity, nothing major, just equal pain for a lover who jilted her. Or similarly, she admits to not being able to say, God bless you, to someone who hurt her. In a certain way, she said, as she said, she's keeping it real. Her very, I think, her very human pedigree is showing. Now, I want to just wrestle with that pan-entheistic something a little bit. So, God is not only in the flowers and the trees, but is the personal being who cares for individuals and to whom a cult needs to be given at some point. Her venturing into the realm, what I consider to be really pan-entheism, is unwitting, however. Interestingly, I found that in the modern theological and philosophical discourse around God, there has been a rejection of classical theism, the God of the philosophers. Classical theism asserts that God is transcendent, self-sufficient, eternal, and immutable, omniscient and omnipotent in relationship to the world. God neither changes through time nor is affected by God's creation. However, this God of classical theism has been challenged by some contemporary theologians from both biblical and philosophical perspectives. Challengers present various relational alternatives, from minor modifications to major revisions to varieties of panentheism to new versions of a sort of naturalistic pantheism. According to Cooper, panentheism affirms that although God and the world are ontologically distinct and God transcends the world is in God ontologically. Classical theism, on the other hand, presents an unqualified distinction between God and creation. Although related, God and creation are always different from each other. Cooper argues convincingly that because there are such widely differing understandings of panentheism, some theologians are panentheists and are not aware of it. In his eyes, various kinds of panentheism inform much of liberation theology, feminist theology, and ecological theology. This is because, in different ways, these theologians emphasize the liberation of specific groups of people as part of the reconciliation and communion of the whole cosmos in God. Really, really worth thinking about. He further claims that understanding panentheism is necessary for anyone who is theologically literate. I don't consider myself to be theologically literate then. But I recognize that even a theologically outschooled Jamaican Sinji can call us to reflection on such weighty matters. Now, where does that leave us in the time that we have left? Where I think it leaves us, perhaps, is with her concern for a new day, for a new religion. And she does call for that. And, you know, in the discussion I had, other things I want to talk about, like how she sees the human-divine relationship, how she sees evil and matters like that. But she has this whole notion of a new day. And you heard a little bit of it because it came up in What a Day. And it sounds kind of apocalyptic, you know, because she had this vision for a whole other plane where the spiritual can flourish again. And she said she's waiting for fire to rain. One down, everything has started clean again. Oh, very frightening. It's not a new vision, though, guys. This sort of apocalyptic way of viewing the world and the coming to the end of the world is something that's there in the West. It's pretty much a part of our Christian, you know, tradition in some sort of way. So it's not even new to the Caribbean, if we think about it. I think she's presenting to us the influence of a particular strand of Christianity, though, that welcomes the destruction of the world as a sign of the end times and the return of Christ. So you know, you hear them on the TV all the time, counting down what's going on in the book of Revelations and trying to tie it in with, you know, conflict in the Middle East or the Iraqi war and so on. So it's pretty much a part of what's out there in our Christian community. Some of these Christians find their warrant, so to speak, in a verse, for example, in Revelations chapter 11, verse 18, that says the time has come to destroy the destroyers of the earth. But they read that as the destruction of the earth and not the destruction of those that are destroying the people of God, in quotation marks. She has a lot of overlap, I think, with the Rastafarian proclivity for burning all things that have to do with Babylon, you know. Rasta see the current social order as being ripe for chanting down this whole notion of prophetic denunciation and cursing. And believe it or not, among their favorite targets for denunciation is the Roman Catholic Church. And of course, the US and the American Imperium. But I want to leave you with a recognition, though, that actually, while it sounds like she's into burning and the destruction of the earth, she's actually not. There's a strong sense of an impending end that pervades much of the apocalyptic discourse of the New Testament, as Lutheran theologian Barbara Rossing reminds us. Rossing is clear, however, that for the most part, early Christian texts do not primarily envision the destruction of the earth or the created world. Rather, in proclaiming the dawning of a new age in Christ, they are envisioning the end of the Roman Imperium based on oppression and injustice. The apocalyptic language is deliberately chosen to counter Rome's imperial and eschatological claim to eternal hegemony and to underscore the urgent coming of a new age. The fiery imagery reflects the conviction that the old imperial order is passing away and the reign of God is taking root. The expectation is both destruction and regeneration. Tanya's dream of a better day can only result from the destruction of the destructiveness that is at play now. There's some kind of paradox at play here. The power of fire to destroy and cleanse lies behind her vision of a new day, a new religion. It's a very hope-filled, yet unwittingly theological vision that must have implications for us, even as we're unremarked Caribbean. I thank you.
And I just want to take this time to thank you for a provocative and theologically stimulating lecture.